Hello everybody, this is Maciej from Poshgui.com and today I will show you some of the layout possibilities in the WPF Designer. We will start by adding a border. A border is a container for one other control, usually used to add a colorful border to that control. We will add a button as its child component, which means when the border will be moved, the button will be moved with it. Now let's select the button and take a look at its layout properties. We will start with the width and the height, as they are pretty self-explanatory. We can change the width of the button by changing this property. Same with the height. Next, let's take a look at the alignment properties. We have the horizontal alignment, which by default is set to left, and the vertical alignment, which is set to the top, which means that whenever the application will be resized, the button will always stay the exact same amount of space to the top edge of its parent container, which is the border now, and to the left edge of its container. Let's take a look. I will resize the border, and we can see the button has not moved. It's exactly the same amount of space between the top and left edge of the border as before the resizing. This amount of space I'm talking about is the margin property. Whenever you are moving a control like a button, you are actually changing its margin property. If I want this to be exactly 100% pixels from the top and the left edge of the border, I can set it in the properties panel. Next, let's take a look at changing the horizontal alignment to right and vertical alignment to bottom. As you can see, the button has moved to the bottom right corner. That is because right now its margins are not calculated based on the left and top edge of the parent container, but the bottom and right one. And the bottom and right one margins currently are zero. So let's move the button a little bit, but it will stay in the bottom right corner. Now it will always stay the same amount of margin between the right and bottom edge. Let's resize the border. And we can see no matter the size of the border, it will always stay in its bottom right corner. Next, let's take a look at the stretch alignment, which is usually used to fill its parent container. If I will change the horizontal alignment to stretch, it will just center itself. But with stretch, you don't really want to use the width property or any margins. So we will zero the right margin and set the width to zero. As we can see, the button has filled all of the space of the border. So if I will resize its parent container, it will always fill its space horizontally. If you would like to have a little space between the edges, we can specify the left margin and the right margin. So the stretch alignment still fills the space of the border, but because of the margins, we can see this 10 pixel spacing between it. It works exactly the same with vertical alignment. We can set it to stretch and delete the height of the button and its bottom margin, and it will fill the height of the border and will resize with it accordingly. Again, we can add a 10 pixel margin to the top and to the bottom of the border, and we can see how the button reacts. You can achieve this also by right-clicking a control and specifying fill parent. This is to make it more easy between setting the width, height and the margins to zero. You can just click fill parent and it will delete any of the properties including the margin. But let's undo it for a second. Now let's take a look at the padding property. We will set this on the border. So we will set padding to 50 pixels on the left, right, bottom and top. What it means? That there is amount of space inside the parent container, which is the border, that will always space all the elements. So if we will fill parent the button, you will see it will actually not fill the whole parent, because this 50 pixels right here is the padding of the border, so we use it as an inward spacing for the controls. This is useful because you don't have to specify the margins for every single control that you have within the parent container. You can just set padding on it and it will space all of the controls that are inside of it. These are the most common properties you are setting on a control to make the layout how you want it. However, you can also use some special containers with additional possibilities. So let's delete the border and the button right now. If I would want a list of controls, so a text block to act as a label to a text box to actually get the input from the user. Let's say we want to have a result text box. We want to have a button so the user can take an action. I could play around with the margins of these controls to make them look like a list from top to bottom. However, I can also use a stack panel. So a stack panel is by default invisible. You will only notice it if you hover over it in the designer. If I would be adding the controls to the stack panel, you can see the stack panel immediately layouts them in a list. This is useful because you don't have to specify all the margins if you would be doing it by hand. The stack panel has also a property called orientation in the common part of the properties. Currently the orientation is vertical, so you can see a vertical list. If I would change it to horizontal, the list would be horizontal. And this is very useful whenever you will want to have lists of controls, like a navigation or a form. The last control I want to show you is a grid component. So I will delete the stack panel for now. The grid is actually added by default to the window when you create a new project. So if I will select the window, I'm actually selecting a grid component that is currently set to fill the parent of the window. And I recommend you always leave it there. When you select a grid, you can see that there is a blue panel at the top edge of the grid and of the left edge. This is used to add columns and rows to the grid just by clicking the panels. You can always resize the columns and rows by dragging the selectors. There are three ways that rows and columns calculate the size of it. Let's take a look at the XAML. We have the column definition, which currently says 381 and a star. This star means it's proportional sizing. So to make it simpler, I will set the width to 3 star of the first column definition and to 7 star for the second column definition. It's proportional sizing. So because the total of these widths in the column definition is 10, the 3 here means the first column will take 30% of space in the grid. And the second column definition, so the second column is right here, will take 70%. The numbers are proportional to each other. If I would want to make it all proportional, so it's all the same size of the cells, I can just add the same number like 1 to each definition. To have a nice even size of the cells. With proportional sizing, it is all resized with the parent container. So if I would resize the window, we can see the grid still contains the same width and height of the columns. However, what if I don't want to have the column being resized? What if I have a column on the left where I will contain my navigation for the application and I want it to stay always the same size, even if the user will resize the app to make it bigger? Well, it's easy. You just specify the number of pixels in the width of the column definition, like 200, and you don't add a star to it. A star means it's a proportional sizing, but right now this column will always be 200 pixels wide. The last calculation of the size of the column we can use is auto. If I will change this width to, say, auto, it will resize itself to the size of the controls that are inside of it. Right now we don't have any controls inside, so it's actually 0% of width. So let's change it to 200 again, add a button to it, and change again the column definition to say auto. You can see that the column stopped resizing when it met the button. So it will always be the size enough to contain the controls inside. If I would make a text block and specify the text that is really wrong, so let's write a really long text inside a text block, the column will resize to show the user actually all of the text. Now that we know how to calculate what the width and height of the grid cells will be, let's take a look how to actually use them. So you specify the columns and rows to create cells. Right now we have 4. I will add a border to this cell, change its background so it is more visible. I will fill parent, and we can see it didn't fill the whole grid. It just filled this specific cell it's currently in. The grid makes it really easy to create containers. When you move a control between the cells, you can see in the XAML, you actually specify in which row and column the control should be in. So currently the really long text inside the text block is in the first column, in the first row, but it is based on zero indexing, so it's actually in the column number 0 and the row number 0. We can change it in XAML, but we can also change it in the properties layout. So there is the grid row and grid column property, currently 0. If I would want to move it to the bottom row, I can just change it to 1. With these 4 cells, we can structure our layout. For example, we can have the navigation on the left and the content, for example, for the user input on the left. But what if we actually want this border to fill the second cell here? Well, we need to use a column span property. Column span is in the layout grid column span. It specifies the numbers of columns to the right that the border should treat as one cell. Currently, we don't have any columns to the right, so we will move it to the first cell and fill parent. So right now, the border fills the first cell in the first column in the first row. I will add the column span that says 2, and that means it should treat two columns as one cell. So the 0 column and the 1 column are treated as one cell for the border. So if we would resize the grid, we can actually create a really nice up bar. For example, if we would to add a nice text that says Poshgui, we will specify it like that, the text, and let's make it a little bigger and bold. Right now, with the column span, we have created a really nice up bar. We have one column here that we can, for example, use for navigation, and a cell that we can create the content in. Using the combination of features I have shown you today, you can create really complex layouts, really nice looking applications. But you don't necessarily need to use everything at once. If you are creating a simple application many times, a simple stack panel with some controls for input from the user and execution of the function will be enough. But if you are creating a complex application, it's nice to get accustomed to all of the things I have shown you today. Thanks for watching. I hope you will create some awesome stuff on the site.